Are you all informed, updated? Are you all tired of info? Well, we're glad you're here, and good morning to all of you. So, tell you what, you just keep playing. I'm just going to say a short prayer, and then we're going to get going. Lord, we thank you for this day. We know that it is a gift from you, and we just ask that you would meet us here, Father. We've come to exalt you and to worship you. And our desire is that we could do that, that you would be pleased. So meet us here, move in our midst, and accept our praise. In your name, Jesus, amen. Let's rise to your feet. Let's join our voices singing to our Lord and our God.
Yours will be the only name that matters to me, the only one whose favor I see. Yours will be the friendship and affection I need to feel my Father smiling on me, the only name that matters to me. And yours is the name that saved me, mercy and grace, the power that forgave me, and your love is all I ever needed. Yours will be the only name that matters to me, the only one whose favor I see, the only name that matters to me. And yours is the name that saved me, mercy and grace, the power that forgave me, and your love is all I've ever needed.
Will be one name that I proclaim.
So I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemy.
Let's pray. I raise a hallelujah. I look at that word, God, hallel meaning praise, yah meaning God. We sing praise to God. Lord, you established a family, which I am so grateful for. I look to my left and I look to my right, and I realize I'm looking at family. Those that are not biological family, but those that are the family of God. And I say praise God for those that realize that they were separated in their sin from you, that accepted that your son bridged that gap between you and us. They've accepted that, and then they have become part of that family of God. I look to the left and the right, and I realize this is my family that I will go into eternity with, that maybe for a short time I would be separated from, but that in eternity I will spend all eternity with them. Lord God, this was your plan. You wanted family with you, And I praise Lord God for your son that made that possible. I praise God for the message that you sent out, that we realize what your plan was. We may be separated today from our Christian family. And there are those watching on video today who we may never meet in this world, but that are part of that family. We praise you, Lord God, for them as well. So we just say, Lord God, thank you for the establishment that you've made and for the message that you have passed on to us, that we know your plan and we can accept that plan. In Jesus' name, I thank you for this, Lord God. Amen.
Amen. Aren't you glad you can sing? Yeah. It's good to gather and it's good to worship. And we need to come and gather together and encourage one another. The Lord said in Matthew 11, he says, come to me, all of you who are weary and carry heavy burdens. I can give you rest. He says, take my yoke upon you and let me teach you, because I am humble and gentle at heart. And if you do, you will find rest for your soul. For my yoke is easy to bear, and the burden I give you is light. We all come from different places. Some burdens are heavier than others. But the Lord says, no matter where you are, come to me. I can help you. I will help you. And that's why we come, because we know he's always there. So this next song we're going to start out singing is new. It's called Run to the Father. And it's just an invitation that the Lord has always given to us every day about come to me and I will help you. So we're going to sing the first verse and chorus, and then we'll keep going. You can join in if you want, or just look at the words. Maybe, Grace, maybe put the words up front for them too, even while we're singing. And let the words speak to you today. Give your burden to him.
I've carried a burden long on my own. I wasn't created to bear it alone. I hear your invitation to let it all go. I see it now, laying it down, and I know
join us, or you can just let the word speak to you.
You saw my condition, had a plan from the start. Your son for redemption, the price for my heart. I don't have a done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, oh, again and again and again and again. Oh,
glad that he's always there. That as you walk through life and you face them times, that you can always run to the Father, and he's always waiting for us. That's why we're here to worship him, because he loves us so much. And no matter what happens, he'll get us through it, and he'll never let go. So let's rejoice in that as we sing that in our last song.
And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. And even when I walk in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know you.
Father God, we've come here this morning, gathered in your name, Lord, to seek you, to praise you, to exalt you, and also to receive from you, Lord. As we look out, we know there's a variety of hurting hearts this morning and heavy burdens that are being carried. Lord, you are the source of strength, and we've come through these doors because of you, because we need you. Lord, I just ask right now that you would minister to those hurting hearts, to those hearts that are carrying a burden that they can't get above yet, and it seems so heavy. Oh Lord, you are the burden bearer. You are the way maker. In your strength, Lord, just meet them. And just help us to turn it over. Help us, Lord, to lay it down and lay it at your feet. As you said in Matthew, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Oh Lord, help us to do that daily. So we seek you, we need you. We proclaim that you are God and that you are our Savior and our Redeemer by faith, and that in you we have a hope, and that you will provide us with what we need to get through each day. So thank you for this time. Thank you for your goodness. Most of all, for your faithfulness to us again and again and again. We ask it all in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen.
Greg is not here today. He usually gives me a pep talk before I come up to preach. And he always has some kind of witty saying that I always respond to in kind. And so today I had something prepared, but he wasn't here, so I'm a little bit disappointed. But the comeback was, buckle up. So if anybody sees him between now and next Sunday, you can refer that message from me. Buckle up. So if you read the title of the sermon, it's how to be better than the person next to you. It's kind of catchy. So finding himself desperately in need of some money, a man living in a small rural community decided to go to the city and go to the local zoo, hoping to find a job feeding the animals. Although such an opportunity was not available, the manager, seeing the size and the strength of the applicant, suddenly got an idea. You know, he said, there are few creatures who attract attention like a gorilla. Would you be willing, because ours died yesterday, to dress in a fursuit and imitate him for a few days? The hungry man agreed to try, and he was quite successful as he beat his chest, bellowed, and shook the bars of his cage, to the amusement of the zoo's visitors, who had said they had never seen a gorilla with such intelligence. One day, while swinging on his trapeze, he accidentally lost his grip and fell into the lion's den. The huge beast gave a ferocious roar, and backing away, the imposter realized that he could not cry out for help without giving away that he was a fake. He tried to retreat, crawling back into his own cage, but the lion stopped him. Finally, in desperation, he yelled, "Help!" Immediately, the lion said in a hushed undertone, "Shut up, or you'll get us both fired." In another community, folks were celebrating a festival when a man waiting in line for the food vendor noticed a pastor from one of the local churches with a can of beer in his hand. A pastor who had spoken out on many occasions against consuming alcohol. Enraged at the man's hypocrisy, he approached him and screamed, "The church is full of hypocrites." The pastor looked at him, quietly opened his can of root beer, and calmly said, "Why don't you join? One's not going to make any more difference." These stories illustrate a common theme. The theme is hypocrisy. A theme that can be summed up in the old proverb, "Do not be afraid or ashamed to sell the family parrot to the town gossip." Hypocrisy is defined as the practice of claiming to have moral standards or beliefs to which one's own behavior does not conform. In other words, it's pretending to be something you're not. It's talking the talk, but not walking the walk. As the sermon title suggests, and what you may have already guessed, is we're going to discover what one needs to do to be better than the person next to them. You don't have to search this out on social media. You don't have to go to the dark web, pop it in Google, find it in some secret manuscript someplace. I'm just going to give it to you. Are you guys ready? Okay, I'm seeing some heads shaking. Okay, here's the secret. The number one most effective way to be better than the person next to you is to be a hypocrite. to manage your image, to put on a mask that flawlessly hides the brokenness within us that comes from a result of our fallenness. Hypocrisy is insidious. It's a treacherous and deceitful trap, and it's ever present, not only in our lives, but in the church. I once read a section of a book that talked about the elements of a good trap. First, a good trap needs to be easy to get into, but hard to get out. Second, it needs to have good bait. Good bait will occupy the attention of the prey while keeping it blind to the dangers that surround it. Third, a good trap puts the prey in a position to where the more it struggles, the more trapped and tired it becomes. A wolf trap is an example of this, and I don't know how many of you are familiar with that kind of trap. But these traps have sharp teeth, and the more the wolf struggles, the deeper the teeth bite. The more it hurts, the harder the wolf struggles. This cycle will continue until the wolf struggles to death. And I want to pause here if you think that trap, a trap created by people, is horrible, just think about the traps our adversary can create for us. As a lot of you know, I work in the field of mental health, and I can attest that I have seen a world filled with unseen traps, traps that destroy people's lives. The last feature of a good trap is it has to attract the prey that it's hoping to catch. Hypocrisy meets all those qualifications for us. It's easy to do, but once we start, it's hard to stop. It lures us in with the belief that we can be better than the person next to us, or maybe just better than how we actually are. The more and more we struggle to be better than those around us, the more and more we have to pretend to be something we're not. The more and more we pretend to be something we're not, ironically, the more like ourselves we become. This cycle will continue again and again. When we are triggered with the reality of who we truly are, the harder we'll pretend. And we will just do this until we destroy our lives. We'll destroy our peace, our joy, our relationships. Lastly, hypocrisy is the perfect trap for a fallen people who desire standing that they once had before their Creator. People who crave completeness. In other words, people who have arrived, people who have it all put together. Today we're going to explore a trap not designed to kill wolves, but designed to destroy your spiritual life. The most insidious thing about hypocrisy is that it can provide us with a temporary euphoria about ourselves. It can convince us temporarily that we are better than the people around us. And if you want to be better than the person around you, you have to be a hypocrite. When I want to learn something and learn it well, I look to the experts, the people who do it the best. The Bible gives us an example of those who were experts in this area. We have the example of the Pharisees. Nobody does hypocrisy as good as them. They were better than the people around them, and they knew it. This is part one of a two-part sermon series from the book of Matthew. Today we're going to look at their professional qualifications, and next week we're going to look at the cure for hypocrisy and practical ways of addressing it in our own personal lives. So if you'd like to follow along in your Bible or electronic device, we're going to be looking at the book of Matthew, chapter 23. This chapter begins shortly after the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem, which we find in Matthew 21. It's a turning point in the book of Matthew. Up until this point, Matthew has been giving his readers a glimpse of the future king and his future kingdom. Matthew has been developing this theme since the beginning of the book. He introduced us to the promised king. He provided his credentials, including power over disease, power over demonic forces, over men, over life itself. And now we're shifting from Jesus' early successful ministry and his triumphal entry, which is his official presentation to the Jews living in Jerusalem, where people come and they yell, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heavens." Matthew tells us the whole city is stirred, wanting to know who this man is. And now we're shifting to their ultimate rejection of their king. We pick up after Jesus has been confronted by the Pharisees, and he's now back in the temple preaching. And this is where we get to see the qualifications. Let's take a look at Matthew 23, verses 1 through 4. Then Jesus said to the crowds and his disciples, The teachers of the law and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat. So you must be careful to do everything they tell you, but do not do what they do, for they do not practice what they preach. Jesus begins his discourse by confronting those who taught the law and the Pharisees. He says they sit in Moses' seat. Some scholars believe that this was the most prominent seat in the synagogue. But really, it most likely means that their traditions were rooted in Moses' teachings, and they fancied themselves his successors in their generation. You needed to believe them because their authority was in the law of Moses. They were Moseses of their time. There is a modern-day theme present that maybe you've come in contact with, which is the belief that certain types of churches are more like the churches from the New Testament, meaning they do things the right way. Like the Pharisees, they hold the belief that they are better than those around them because they are doing things the right way. These churches not only claim they're doing it right, but they're the only surviving church from the New Testament that somehow miraculously the Lord protected their way of thinking, their polity, and has done this throughout the ages, and every other church has it wrong. They often highlight this to potential members. You should come here. You should worship with us and fellowship with us in this way because we have the right way. Our church is better than the rest. Our authority is the only authority. And people in places like this have a sense of creating weight, not only in their foundation, but in their practice. And ironically here, Jesus is telling us to obey the Pharisees and the teachers of the law. But really, it's not them, it's the Old Testament. Unfortunately, they are teaching truths, but they do not practice what they preach, which is hypocrisy. Jesus goes on in verse 4, they tie up heavy, cumbersome loads and put them on other people's shoulders, but they themselves are not willing to lift a finger to move them. They tied up heavy burdens on people. They made religion heavy. Maybe you've experienced that in your life before. Maybe you've experienced this at a church where grace and mercy are minimized and burdens are maximized. Maybe instead of Jesus' call to those who are heavy laden to come to him because his load is light and his yoke is easy, you've experienced an interpretation of Jesus or a counterfeit Jesus who expects perfection from you, who demands the utmost always. I once read about a survey placed in a local church bulletin of a large church, and it began by asking the members to check themselves and included the statement, if people were like you, would they be in Sunday school, be on time, bring a Bible, study the right verses, bring an offering, attend morning service, evening service, small group, make an effort to worship, play an instrument, bring somebody with them, invite somebody to their home. For every one they were able to check, and they were asked to do so, they would get 10 points. If they got everything right, they got 100 points, and the bulletin said they were the perfect example. 90, you were just about right. 80, you were starting to slip. 70, watch your step. And lastly, and this is word for word, 60, you're an emergency case. And it ended with the statement, 6 successful Sundays and Sunday school continues this Sunday. Be there, with a lot of exclamation points. Do you think after a test like this, your spiritual burden is heavier or lighter? Do you think you would feel more sensitive to the voice and prompting of the Holy Spirit in your life? Or pressure to conform, pressure to manage your image, or maybe even to perform for the church or the pastor? Maybe you've never experienced this at church, but you have a job where your boss is an expert at creating extremely stressful situations for you and then puts all that responsibility upon your shoulders to fix. Or maybe your boss is really good at delegating things that they themselves would never actually do. I'm seeing some smiles, so I think some people can relate to that. Maybe you've experienced this in your family, where someone in your family is very good at putting burdens on other people and do nothing to help. The next qualification is found in verse 5. Everything is done for people to see. They make their phylacteries wide and the tassels on their garments long. They do everything for people to see. They want to be noticed. Does this remind you of social influencers, people on social media? They crave attention. They lived by the motto, first impressions never get a second chance. When they interacted with their communities, they put on a costume and they wore a mask and they played a role. It reminds me of a story I once heard about a rather pompous-looking elder from a non-denominational church, not Kyle, who was teaching a group of children about the importance of the Christian life. And he said in a very deep voice, "Why do people believe I'm a Christian? Or how do people know I'm a Christian?" And some young person looked at him and said, "Maybe it's because they don't know you." Pretty harsh, right? On a more serious note, and this is a true story, I spent an entire semester training to be a pastor in Bible college. I will not mention the Bible college because some folks of you have been there. And we spent an entire semester learning that the most important thing that a pastor needed to do was look the part. In particular, what colored suit to wear for which church occasion. The passage gives us an example of the costumes they are choosing to wear. It says they make their phylacteries wide. Phylacteries were small pouches put on the left hand and the forehead. And they contained passages of scripture from the Old Testament that would be brought out and read during times of prayer. The passage says that they were conspicuous. It's like a big logo affixed to their forehead that says, "I am better than you. I love God more than you because of my obedience. Respect me. Take me serious." But it all comes down to the fact that they demanded attention. It also says their tassels were long. These are prayer tassels. And the length of them made them noticeable. They were a walking commercial on how to live your life the right way. But not only did they draw attention to themselves, verses 6 and 7 tell us more. They also loved the place of honor at banquets and the most important seats in the synagogues. They loved to be greeted with respect in the marketplace and to be called rabbi by others. They, like so many of us, loved honor. When I was a kid, I was desperately in love with wrestling. Hulk Hogan, Ric Flair, Shawn Michaels, and the list goes on and on. I was glued to the television watching the heroes of my youth, big, sweaty men beating up on each other, dressed in fancy costumes. Some of them even had dances and things that they would do. And I'll never forget, one day my dad came home from the steel mill, and he said, "Son, I've got some tickets to see a wrestling event at the Kiel." Now, for those of you who do not know, the Kiel's no longer in existence, but it was the downtown, unsafe downtown arena in St. Louis. I was so excited. For a month, I waited with eager anticipation. And then the day came. I still remember the sights and the smells as we walked into the stadium. And I remember my dad taking me into this big boxed room with comfy leather seats that were so close to the wrestlers, I felt like I could touch them. And that's when my dad informed me of the bad news, that these seats were for wealthy people, that these seats were for people of importance. These were not our seats. And we began our ascent into what is aptly known as the nosebleed seats. And if you know me and know me well, you know that I am absolutely terrified of heights. It was worse as a child. I didn't see one moment of the event. And if you could remember, or if you had known about the Kiel, we were at the very top. You could look straight down, and the glass that kept you from falling was that big. I never even opened my eyes, and my dad had to carry me back to the car. I learned an important lesson that day, that some folks get the best seats, and some folks are forgotten. The Pharisees got the best seats. They got the box seats, the ringside seats. They were not in the nosebleed seats. They were the ultimate front row Baptist. If you've ever heard that phrase before. I once attended a church where the front pews were the most coveted pews in the entire church. It was rare to find an empty spot amongst them. One might think this was because people thirsted and yearned for the Word of God, but it was not. A new pastor had come, and he had started to preach that people who loved God sat in the front three pews. And at first, it had little effect on the church. But a while after hearing this repetitive theme, one by one, families started to move closer and closer. But there was still a group of us less godly folks, myself included, who were holding out in the back pews. After a few months, the message started to change. To those who love God, sit up in the front. To those who don't love God, sit in the back pews, because they are unable to withstand God's holiness like the people up front. This is a true story. Again, one by one, people started to migrate to the front until there was only one lone person who dared to sit in the back. And you might guess by now that, yes, it was me. Soon, the message changed again. To some folks, just don't get it. Some folks are causing disunity within the church. The pastor started to make passionate statements from the pulpit of how they had to remove this temptation. A few weeks later, all the back pews were removed from the church. The Pharisees and the teachers of the law would have never had this issue. They would have pushed and they would have shoved their way to those coveted seats. But they just didn't like the seats. They loved to be greeted with respect and to be called rabbi. They craved power. Rabbi here doesn't mean teacher. It has connotation of master. Master is one who has the power and the authority to rule over others. Instead of one master, one teacher, Jesus, there were many lesser teachers, lesser masters found in God's own people. To recap, they taught the law, but they didn't practice it. They placed heavy burdens on others that they themselves would not be able to tolerate. Everything they did for approval. They wore a costume to hide who they truly were. And they loved honor and being masters over others. Let's take a quick look at some of their methods. There are seven, but we're only going to talk about three. The first thing we can do to be better than everyone else, like the Pharisees, is to major on the minors. Major on the minors. This simple phrase describes the exact opposite of don't sweat the small stuff, or sweat the small stuff, excuse me. Jesus tells us in verse 23, "Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites. You give a tenth of your spices, mint, dill, and cumin." There was a practice of the time that the Pharisees had where they would tithe of all their possessions. They went as far as to tithe from their smallest spices. They just didn't tithe. They tithed better than everyone else. They didn't give 10% of their income. They didn't give sporadically. They gave of everything to the point where they were in their houses trying to measure out God's portion from their spice rack. Could you imagine being in your kitchen with your salt shaker and your pepper shaker, a measuring cup, a food scale, trying to measure out God's portion to put in the collection plate on Sundays? But they were clearly doing better than everyone else. I once heard a sermon by Chip Ingram where he used the story of his life where he said he was going to be the best Christian he could be. Good Christians tithe 10%, so he was going to tithe 20 or 30% of his income. Because if 10 was good, 20 or 30 was better, it was best. And as he said, a surefire way to become a hypocrite. But Jesus continues, "But you have neglected the more important matters of the law, justice, mercy, and faithfulness. You should have practiced the latter without neglecting the former." The Pharisees and their intense practices had begun to focus on the minutiae of the law, the most minor details, while missing the big picture. While they were in their kitchens, measuring, weighing, counting grains of sand, they neglected justice and mercy and faithfulness. It's not that we should throw out the little things. It's not that we should throw out the details or that we should avoid doing what the Lord asks us to do. But we need to have an adequate picture. We need to have an adequate understanding of the big picture. Then Jesus gives us an interesting picture of how he sees their focus on the minor. Verse 24 tells us, "You blind guides, you strain out a gnat, but you swallow a camel." Kind of a weird statement there. It might sound humorous, it's clearly hyperbole, which exaggerates the previous statement Jesus has just made. Under Levitical law, both the camel and the gnat were considered ceremonially unclean. The gnat, obviously, the smallest, and the camel, the biggest. So if I were to ask volunteers from the congregation to come up and choose between eating a camel and a gnat, I could guess, unless you were really hungry, that you would probably choose the gnat. But yet, that is what Jesus is accusing them of. And though this might sound odd to us, the Jews of Jesus' time would have understood it completely. The Pharisees during that time had a tradition where they would strain out insects from their wine. There was no refrigeration at the time, and insects were more of an issue. It was common for flies to get into wine as it was pressed in open air. The Pharisees would sift their wine through their teeth, collecting flies and bugs and gnats, and they would either spit them out or pick them out before they would consume their wine. Jesus' message would have been clear to them. You expel all that energy, all that work for something of little consequence, but you pay no mind to the big things of life. You strain out the gnats, but you swallow the camels. And how many times do we struggle with the same? The next thing you can do to be better than the person next to you is manage your image, but not your heart. Manage your image, but not your heart. Verse 27 tells us this: "Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites! You are like whitewashed tombs, which look beautiful on the outside, but on the inside are full of the bones of the dead and everything unclean. In the same way, on the outside you appear to people as righteous, but on the inside you are full of hypocrisy and wickedness." The Jews of this time would paint tombs bright white each springtime before Passover to warn passerbys to avoid them. The reason? Nothing spread ritual impurity as quickly as touching a dead body. It was equivocal to a modern-day game that I like to play with the youth occasionally called Zombies. The game is relatively simple. There are survivors and there are zombies. The survivors run and hide, and the zombies go to find them. If you're tagged by a zombie, you become a zombie, just like in the lore. Eventually, everybody either becomes zombies or the survivors win. For the Jews, touching a dead body was the most unclean thing they could do, and they could spread it. They had to be in quarantine for nearly a week after touching a dead body. But the Pharisees, being better than that, took it to the next level. They believed and taught that one contracted impurity not only by touching a corpse, but if your shadow touched a corpse or even a gravesite, you became unclean. The bright white tombstones were like warning signs. Do not go there. Do not do that. It's ironic how much effort they went in to warn other people when they themselves did not heed the warning. In fact, in the passage, Jesus says they are the whitewashed tombs. They look beautiful on the outside because of their religious conformity. But on the inside, they are dead. And don't get me wrong, holiness compared to their fake holiness is wonderful. It's beautiful. God's holiness both attracts us with warmth and love and blessing and illuminates who we truly are. But their holiness is death. It's a dark light of generations of the dead. Jesus calls it everything that is unclean. They have an equal measure of false holiness and true wickedness. The illustration that Jesus is giving is ironic and yet clear at the same time. It's a stark warning. a sign that says, do not go there, do not do that. Anyone whose life touches the life of the Pharisee becomes unclean, becomes death. But Jesus has one last woe for the Pharisees, one that truly shows the depth of their hypocrisy. The last method to be better than everyone else, to be better than the person next to you, is to have confidence that you're different. To have confidence that you're different than everyone else. And that somehow you are above those who came before. Verse 29 tells us this. Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites. You build tombs for the prophets. You decorate the graves of the righteous. And you say, if we had lived in the days of our ancestors, we would not have taken part in the shedding of the blood of the prophets. Here we see Jesus describing the practice of the time that the Pharisees would build elaborate tombs for the dead, and they would proclaim with gusto, with righteousness, that if they had lived during the time of their ancestors, they would not have shed the blood of the prophets. And before you think this does not apply to modern day thinking, I have heard many a righteous Christian say that if they had been around during the time of Jesus, he would not have been crucified. But like a popular proverb, like father, like son, Jesus is going to call these Pharisees out. Verse 31 tells us this. So you testify against yourselves that you are the descendants who murdered the prophets. Go ahead then, complete what your ancestors started. Jesus, who entered Jerusalem as a king, was starting to look much less like a miracle and more like a spectacle. And he was already beginning to teach those around him that his fate was not what they had imagined. He was not coming to be a king, but a criminal. That he was coming to Jerusalem not to rule, but to die. This passage is one of the most potent examples of his true mission, as well as the depth and the evil of the hearts of his own people. The Pharisees testified to their own damnation. They who claimed to be better than those before them were just as guilty, but to a crime much greater than their predecessors. The people before them, their ancestors, they had murdered mere instruments of the Lord. They had murdered sinful people, sinful human beings just like us, people who were guilty like us. But the Pharisees were already planning to kill the innocent Son of God. Jesus, who is aware of this and aware of the task that is set before him, has told them to go ahead and do what their ancestors had started, which is try to destroy God's plan. They failed. Amen? The Pharisees, the ultimate hypocrites, who were really only good at one thing, destruction. They did not practice what they preached. They were probably great advice givers. Maybe some of you folks have friends like that who are really good at giving you advice that they themselves would not actually do. They would have been great preachers. Their sermons would have been filled with theology and doctrine, but they would not have had any practical application. They had fallen into a good trap, a trap designed by the forces of darkness to kill. And then they replicated it to the destruction of many. I hope you come back next week as we're going to take a look at the cure for hypocrisy and practical steps on how to escape this insidious and destructive trap. Let's pray. Father, Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for your word. Thank you for this confrontation that you have given us a glimpse of. Lord, mask wearing is very destructive. It hides who we truly are. It forces us to pretend. It leaps destruction. It dumps upon us burden after burden after burden. We cannot connect with those around us. We cannot ask for the help that we need, because to do so, we would have to remove the mask. I pray as we go into the week that we would remove our mask. Maybe not to everyone, but to someone. Maybe even to you. Lord, I know myself that I have oftentimes prayed as if you cannot truly hear me. And I have prayed as if you are some kind of stranger. And I have not talked with you directly because I'm wearing a mask on the inside. But you know all. You know who I truly am, and you still love me. Lord, as we go out, give us the strength to unmask. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. All right, and as you go out, may the Lord be with you and bless you.